have to show you pictures.
Well, good morning, Grand Henry.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How many of you blew in on that nice spring breeze? Well, I really think when I came this morning, I think there was a couple of people picking their head
up. Oh, yeah. I believe it.
Excuse me. Bad joke. Anyhow, I'm so glad to see you all here. You know, I've told you before, but I will never close this church. So that I want you always to be safe, take care of yourself, that we will get through it. And I'm glad you're all here this morning. It's been kind of always a letdown after Easter and Christmas. We've talked about Easter this last week. My wife's giving me this one. She knows I'm not doing real well this morning, so she's keeping an extra close eye on me. And Judy said she's saying extra prayer. Speaking of extra prayers, I know this is from Steeler, one of yours. Cecil is over in Bethany home and has been. But he's been a little weak. Marcus has been checking on him. His family's been checking on him. So I just might say an extra prayer for Cecil, please. Okay. What do you have, Mr. Bubble?
This is a reminder, this is not 2022. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
A couple of birthdays this week, Sherry Oakland, tomorrow, January 3rd. Kathy Toler, January 6th. The United Methodist Men's meeting for tomorrow night has been canceled. Wayne is sick, so it's been canceled. There will be a board meeting Tuesday night at 6 p.m. So all board members, please plan on being here. Next Saturday, January 8th, 10 a.m., we'll be taking down all the Christmas decorations. So please come and help. That's all I have.
Thank you, Bill. Let us now come into worship with the flame of our prayer and the lighting of our candles. We will be lighting the Christ candle again this morning as he continues to do this work.
Thank you.
Christ goes before us and continues to lead us. I can think of a better song to sing, start the service this morning, and lead on, O King.
Please join me in the prayer of illumination. O God,
you made of one blood all nations,
and
by a star in the east revealed to all peoples him whose name is Emmanuel. Enable us who know your presence
with us,
so to profit life with unsearchable riches,
that all may
come to his light, and bow before the brightness of his rising,
who
lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning, our first scripture reading, is from Revelation chapter 11, verse 15, and I'm reading from the NIV. The seventh angel sounded by his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us continue to worship his mighty name with our majestic instrument.
Your name in all the earth, O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth, O Lord, we praise you.
Let every breath, all that I have.
Let's now have a time of personal insight and prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, our mighty God, we give you thanks and praise this day. Give you thanks and praise for a new year to serve and to celebrate you. We give you thanks and praise, our Father, for your Son, Jesus Christ. Who came to earth, became man. Who suffered our sins on the cross. And who you raised from the dead. So we ask that you raise us up in new faith and new strength to serve you this day, this week, this month, this year. We do pray, Lord, for those who are sick, those who are struggling with issues of life. We give you thanks and praise that you have sustained us through many difficulties this past year. And we pray, Lord, that you would lead us and guide us, renew our faith, for this coming year that we may serve you. We pray for your church throughout the world, that it may join in our praises, and join in serving you, join in standing in faith against all those who persecute and who seek to destroy you, your church. We pray for our nation, Lord, and our leaders, that they would remember how you brought us into being a nation. And that you would give wisdom to our leaders, that they would guide us in your way of truth and righteousness. And when they don't, Lord, we pray that you will encourage us to pray for them, and that your Holy Spirit would turn them on. Even as you turn us back when we stray. Lord, ever keep us in mind that you are Lord of all the earth and of all our existence. And so, with these remembrances, we now pray as the Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray. Saying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. And we'll have a children's message.
packed it away with this year. And McDonald said, we're going to do that next Saturday. But I want you to take just a minute to look at the beautiful tree with all the chrismons on it, and the lights, and the candles, and all the flowers, and the gardening, and the greenery. It's still beautiful. Even though Christmas is over, it's still beautiful. And I realize some people think that Christmas is over, and all the Christmas stuff should have been boxed up the day after Christmas. When I first met Doug and started going to his parents' house on Christmas morning, our kids would always get up at 5 in the morning, so we were always over at his parents' by 8 in the morning. And one of the saddest things I can ever remember seeing was their next-door neighbor's tree was already thrown out at the curb. Because on Christmas Eve, when they celebrated their Christmas, as soon as the last package was unwrapped, she whipped out the toque, took all the ornaments off, and that tree was out to the curb. And it always made me feel kind of sad, because my kids would say, why is it out there? It's just now Christmas. But for her, from her vantage point, she felt that because their Christmas was over, it was time to move on. No more carols, no more decor, no more Christmas until the Friday after Thanksgiving, the next year. But her actions made me stop and think about it and question, when is Christmas over? I mean, when is the appropriate time to pack up for next year? I'm sure if you ask the retailers, the commercial standpoint would be that it ended on December 24th when they shut the doors. But from a spiritual standpoint, it's never over. Sometimes I think we pack up Christmas too soon. Most of us are so tired from the advertising and rushing around that we can't wait for December 26th to finally rest. With all the commercialization today, is that any wonder? But sometimes I think, sadly enough, even in the church, we may have been tempted to forget or may have already forgotten. And you may be wondering, forget or forgotten what? That Christmas is packaged in a word. A word that became flesh and lived among us. John 1:14 says, and the word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a father's only son, full of grace and truth. God has come to us as a baby born in a manger. You can't get much more personal than that. A word that became flesh and lived among us. And that word still lives among us and in us today. As a result, we can face things that otherwise can't be faced. We can face life's challenges and difficulties when our lives have been packed with Christmas. And I don't mean the things we get on Christmas morning in material possessions. I'm referring to Jesus, the Word that was made flesh for us and walks with us. I read a quote from Mother Teresa the other day, and I thought it summed it up beautifully. She said, it is Christmas every time you let God love others through you. Yes, it is Christmas every time you smile at your brother and offer him your hand. Whenever we allow Christmas to pack into our lives, we discover that it points us to something better, or to look forward to the future. Christmas, a day about a child being placed in a manger, points us to the cross. And on that, this Christ child would die some 30 years later for our sins, and then an empty tomb where a resurrection took place through the very power of God, thus ensuring eternal life for all of us who would believe. And as a result of that belief, we await his second advent, which will result in each of us doing exactly what Jeremiah said we would do. Rejoicing in dance, being merry, being joyful, having gladness, and being satisfied no matter what may come our way. And as we wait, if we allow the Holy Spirit to do his work, we'll be packed with joy and gladness and satisfaction no matter what. Now, I don't know about you, I started trying to pack stuff up the last couple of days at home, and I still got a ways to go. At least I got the outside step before it got too cold. And as you go around packing up and getting rid of the decorations and putting them away, all those things that remind us of our celebration each year, make sure that you don't forget and pack up your faith, your Christmas faith. Your very existence should be packed with Christmas. We need that Christmas faith all year long.
Amen.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, you're no longer a babe in a manger. You are the Lord of lords and King of kings. You are still our hope, our peace, our joy, and our love. Help us to celebrate Christmas in our hearts each and every day of the year. Amen.
Amen.
Of the power and grace and love of our Savior. scripture verse taken from Daniel 7:14 this morning. And it gives us another reminder. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worship him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away. And his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
You know, I'm going to echo some words I just heard. You know, I think we had a really great season at church. Really great season at Advent. And some things we need to be reminded of. We sang songs of Christmas. We sang the songs of our Lord and Savior. And we preached and talked about keeping Christmas in your lives all year long, about letting the light of Christ shine in you every single day. We lit our candles and sang Silent Night. Then we walked out into the night and found the streets ablaze with the other people that were walking in our church. It was one of those Christmas moments, those special Christmas moments. Leaving the church that night after Christmas Eve service, I felt like maybe the world had changed a little. I felt like maybe this would be the year, the one when light and meaning of Christmas would feel close to us all year. The next day of Christmas, as I celebrated with our family, Penny and I felt that feeling again. And again, the next day after that. But, you know, that's one of the words I hate. That's the four-letter words. I hate those three-letter words. But, then late in the week, we had to go to the store to pick up a few things. And I could pick on any store in town, but like, well, now I'll just pick on Target. As you walk through the front doors, you expect that all the Christmas decorations would still be up. You would expect that maybe a few carols would still be playing, that lights would be lit and on. But 5 feet into the store, I realized it wasn't still Christmas at all. In fact, 4 days after Christmas, they were setting up the Valentine's Day surprise displays. So much for the 12 days of Christmas. The retail world will go on no matter what. And it won't be long until Christmas is out of our minds for another 10 months or so. And by the time we make it to the next Christmas Eve, what happens? The whole cycle starts again. You know, some of that's natural, perhaps. We can't stay stuck in one season all year long. But I, like many of you, get so unsettled about how quickly we shift out of Christmas and on to the next best thing. And that's why I do love Christmas, because inside these doors, inside this church, we do, when you think about it, we do celebrate Christmas all year long. And that's why I've continued to light this Christ candle, as a reminder of who is leading us and where we need to go. Mm-hmm. And we keep telling the story too. I think I've read that story several times from Luke to you all about Christ's birth. And it kind of talks about some of my favorite characters from the Christmas story, or perhaps the most overlooked of all. Shepherds. The shepherds aren't near as impressive as the angels. They don't come in on candles with gifts in hand like the wise men. They're not even infamous like the innkeeper who had no room for Mary and Joseph. They're just a bunch of regular Joes And they're out in the field, they're trying to work and sleep and keep the sheep from being eaten. And yet, when Jesus was born, they're the ones that the angels came to tell about the birth. Not kings, not a priest, just a bunch of shepherds that were both terrified and amazed. When the angels left, what did they do? They immediately decided to go and see Jesus for themselves. And they found him just as the angels were told, just born and wrapped up in the manger. And when they met Mary and Joseph, the lowly shepherds told them everything that the angels had said. And everyone who heard them speak was amazed. And there's that famous sentence from Mary. She treasured those words in her heart. Treasured in her heart. It must have been an amazing moment. It would have been even more amazing than that spiritual high that I felt leaving the church on Christmas Eve. They had seen actual angels in the field. They had gone and met this newborn baby. They had experienced it all firsthand for themselves. And then the scripture tells us that they went back out into the fields and kept being shepherds, yet they were also praising God and giving thanks to all. But at the end of the day, they were right back there with the sheep. They had seen the most amazing things, felt the greatest joy in their lives. They had been changed by it all. But out in the fields, the sheep still needed tending, and life still went on. So whether you're a shepherd, or whether you're a shopper, you're going to wonder how you can carry that wonder of what you've seen into a world that just seems unchanged. But that is our challenge. That is our faith. We have these moments of absolute joy and light and understanding. We say that we will carry the light of the Christ candle all year. And then we meet the world in all its busyness. And we need to figure out how to live as transformed people within it. There's a saying in Buddhism, before enlightenment, chop wood and carry water. After enlightenment, chop wood and carry water. In other words, in the aftermath of even the most amazing experiences, you still have to keep doing what you've always done. You still chop the wood, you still tend the sheep, you still buy paper towels in a store that's covered in pink and red hearts. Get my hands to warm in here. But it should be about us. It's not that the world has changed. It is us. If in Christmas, if we open our hearts wide enough, we are transformed by the love and the light of Christ. If we are lucky, we have 12 days to really celebrate before our world goes back to normal. If we are realistic, maybe we only have 2 or 3. But that doesn't mean that we have to go back to. We need to hold ourselves separate from the world. We need to live in Christ's world. Instead, we can be the changed people who now want to make the world better. I don't know the whole story of what the shepherds did when they got back to their sheep, or sure, they kept on being shepherds. But I do wonder what else they did. Did they tell others what they had seen? Did they share the light of Christ by sharing the story? Did their lives change just a little? Did the small daily acts they always done take on a little bit more meaning? My guess is that they did. I believe that because I don't believe that you can experience God without being changed. You cannot do that. And when you are changed, your world changes as well. When you are changed, you become a force for good in a world that needs all the goodness it can get right now. Because you and I are Christmas people, we have been transformed. So now, we go out to transform the world. Tonight, we bring in a new year, pretty close to now. So remember the promises that you gave at Christmas and on Christmas Eve. Remember your promise to let Christ's light shine all the time. Let it shine for others who need to see it. Take time and make the world and the people in your world a little brighter and a little warmer. That's how you'll know that Christmas has changed you. And that's how Christmas will change the world. You know, there's a song, and because of the copyrights, we can't use it anymore. We sang it once back a while ago, and I'd love to sing it again, but we can't. But I can sneak around that a little bit by repeating just a few verses of this. I want you to, and that was my sermon title this morning, if you can only imagine. That's the name of the song, and it says, I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes would see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. It goes on to say, surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I even be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine that when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I'll do is forever, forever worship you. This morning, we will be celebrating communion. I can hold on to everything here this morning. You know, before we start communion, I think it's important that to know that people see you. I watch each and every one of you every service. I can see joy. I can see the sadness. I can see the worship. That's why it is so important that as Christians, we show the world that we need to be followed.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Jesus Christ. Blessed are you for coming among us and for offering yourself to us in this holy meal, to fill our hungry and wandering souls, and to empower us to break free from Satan's hold, to walk humbly with our neighbor and God. With your first disciples on the night of your betrayal unto death, you took bread, and you blessed it, you broke it, and gave it, saying, take and eat this, my body given. Then you took a cup, again you gave thanks, saying, drink this, my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you. Even so, here and now, this day, come to us, Holy Spirit, come to us. Come upon these gifts and make them be for us Christ's body in his blood, that we who receive him may be for all the world Christ's body in his blood. Come to us, Holy Spirit. Make us one today. Come to us, Holy Spirit, and unite us with you. Come to us, Holy Spirit, and revive us. Make us whole and holy on this day, as we await that day when we ourselves shall feast with Christ in the new creation. To Christ, to you, and to the all-merciful Creator, our God, one God, living and true, be all praise and honor and glory, now and forevermore. For those helping with communion this morning, please come forward. I remind you, as always here, that this table is open to everyone who will come. Please come as you are.
Thank you.
thank you. You have fed us with yourself and bound us to you in love, that we may walk with you in this world in the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep these bonds strong through the days ahead, so that in this world we too may make companions of the lost and discover the angels who are at work in our midst. You know, I've been waiting all week long to sing this next song. It's not my hymnals, and I don't know why. It's one of the most beautiful songs. And so I ask you to stand this morning. As you sing, think about what you're singing this morning. A song is Before the Throne of God. Bless you as he has blessed me.